to this year's Antcliffe lecture. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, I'm just going to say a few words about the lecture series itself. This is a series that was set up by a generous donation from the family and friends of John Antcliffe. For people who don't know about John, he was a student in Cambridge in the late 1970s. He studied history, but his other great passion was politics. And this is the year that we launch, which for Cambridge is a momentous thing, a new degree in history and politics, which wasn't available then, but I'm fairly confident that had that been available, it's what John Antcliffe would have chosen to study. He then went on to have a very distinguished career in the city and in public relations, but he remained passionately interested in and committed to politics, both as a practitioner but also as a writer about politics. And following his untimely death, his family and friends created a fund to endow this lecture series and also to endow a fellowship at Churchill College. And I think the Antcliffe Fellow is here, Stephen Kelly, the second Antcliffe Fellow. And Churchill, the Churchill Archive, for people who don't know, contains the Thatcher papers. And that's what you're studying, right? Margaret Thatcher's relationship with the politics of Ireland.
It's a book about Margaret Thatcher and the Northern Ireland Troubles.
Right, which is both a very political and a very historical question. So this is the third John Antcliffe Memorial Lecture. The first was given by Michael Howard, the former Conservative Party leader, and he gave it in the run-up to the 2015 general election. His subject was the legacy of Thatcherism. And last year, it was given by Tristram Hunt, who I want to say he still is of the Labour Party, so it's not like he's no longer, I assume he is still a member of the Labour Party. But since he gave, and I'm not saying this is cause and effect, since he gave last year's lecture, as you probably know, he is no longer the MP for Stoke. He is now director of the Victorian Album Museum. His subject was the challenges facing Labour. So this lecture series both combines very distinguished speakers and very topical subjects, and tonight is no exception. It's a great pleasure to welcome Baroness Wheatcroft, Patience Wheatcroft, who has had a very distinguished career as a journalist and editor, as the city editor of the Times, as the editor of the Sunday Telegraph, as the editor of the Wall Street Journal Europe. In 2010, she became a life peer, and over the last year, she has been very actively involved in the debate around Brexit, asking us to question whether Brexit really means Brexit.
What does Brexit really mean?
The subject of tonight's lecture is politics in a post-truth age, and I think it's fair to say there is no more topical subject than that. So it's a great pleasure to welcome Baroness Wheatcroft.
Thank you very much for that introduction. And I can't tell you how delighted I am to be here, because John was a great friend. We knew him well for a long time, and I still miss him. He should have had a stellar career in politics. He had a stellar career elsewhere, but politics was, as you've heard, his first love. And the electors of Greenwich sadly thought otherwise. I think I should take some responsibility for that fact. John's election leaflet needed a different feel to it when he was fighting the election in 87. So he borrowed my two children and my mother's dog. I thought that the right standard of dress for the children would be a sort of a play it down duffel coat look. My daughter was appalled, scowled throughout, and really didn't help his election chances at all. However, it was typical of John that he bore no grudge, and shortly before he died, he actually presented my daughter with a copy of that election leaflet that he'd had signed by Mrs. Thatcher. He was a star. And as I say, I miss him. Just before he died, he published a reprint of the Times Guide to the general election of 1910, 100 years after the event. It was a perceptive look at what was going on and it's very relevant today. In his foreword, he pointed out that Asquith gave the speech that kicked off the election campaign from the Royal Albert Hall, and John, of course, had been chairman of the Royal Albert Hall, did a fantastic job there. But what was interesting and relevant about the election was that it was all about a battle between the Lords and the Commons. The Lords were determined to overthrow Lloyd George's People's Budget. Lloyd George was equally determined that his budget would survive. The Lords voted by an overwhelming majority that they would not support the bill for the budget without it first being approved by the people. Not a referendum, but an election in that case. It went to the people, and the budget then came back and was passed by a very large majority. But I do think there are interesting parallels with what's going on today, and indeed what's been going on this week. I won't attempt to second guess what John's political position would have been at the moment, although I'm sure you're right about the degree of course he would have chosen. But I can say with a degree of certainty that he would have relished the opportunity to be here this evening to discuss politics in the post-truth age. And that's now my privilege. As we head towards the end of yet another truly momentous week in British politics and the start of what will undoubtedly be the next one. On Monday, we'll see whether the Commons will uphold the amendments that have been passed in the Lords this week. I doubt that, whatever their personal views, there'll be sufficient Tories to carry it through. They will not risk the writ of the Prime Minister. It's easier to be a rebel in the Lords, where unless one is set on a ministerial career, the sanctions are limited to little more than a raised eyebrow from the Chief Whip. That's what I got last week. Unless, of course, one is working in a voluntary capacity to help the government. As Lord Heseltine discovered, one can be stripped of voluntary office. And of course, that was intended to send a very strong message to anyone in the Commons who might be minded to rebel. So the bill's likely to be returned to the Lords without amendment and with some stern injunctions that the unelected chamber should not dare to defeat the will of the elected House. There'll be little appetite for an energetic game of ping pong, and the Lords will give way without much of a fight. So the Article 50 notification of withdrawal bill will become law, and negotiations to extricate the UK from the EU will begin. And while we act on the results of the June 23rd referendum, the country is also preparing for a state visit from Donald Trump. Now, a year ago, I have to confess, I foresaw neither eventuality. Along with many others, I'm left asking whether politics is going through a period of fundamental change, and if so, what has brought it about? In answer to the first question, I refer you to research led by Marvin Barth, a former chief economist of international affairs at the US Treasury. He now advises Barclays, and he's produced what they call a note, but it's 72 pages, I think that's stretching a point. Anyhow, it's a research note on the politics of rage. And his conclusion is that the voter rebellion, symbolized by Brexit and Trump, quote, spans nearly all advanced economies, has been taking place for more than a decade, is unparalleled in modern history, and is deeply entrenched. And that view is shared by Matthew Goodwin, politics professor at the University of Kent. He believes that the populist voter rebellion has been a long time coming, and it's going to harden in the coming years. Certainly in Westminster, there's a real feeling that the change in politics is fundamental, and polling in much of Europe seems to echo that. In France, the Netherlands, Italy, we can see the establishment under threat. Barth looks at 22 different countries in his efforts to chart what's going on. the move towards populism, what he terms the politics of rage. And he's so right about the rage. I've canvassed in elections for many years and always been quite cheered by how pleasant and polite people are. They might say that you're completely mad and they wouldn't dream of voting for your party in a million years. But when I campaigned for Remain in Kent, the reaction was totally different. I've never encountered hostility like it, and it was depressing. People are undoubtedly angry, and it's pushed them away from the political centre ground. Across those 22 countries, Barth found that the combined centre-right and centre-left have collapsed by an average 12%. You can see the effect that has. But whereas populism is often described as a move on the right, in many of these cases, it's actually a drift of the working class from the left to the right, which is changing the shape of politics. Trump came to power on the votes not merely of a core right-wing Republican vote, but because of Rust Belt former Democrats. And if any of you want to see quite why those people might have voted for Trump, I commend to you a book called Deer Hunting with Jesus. It's a pretty hefty-handed book, and it tells the same story over and over again, but examples of people in America whose lives for the last 30 years have been very, very tough and show little sign of getting better. And of course, the worrying thing about them is in the title. Not only do they have guns, but they also feel they've got God on their side. So it could get nasty. The same trend is happening in France, where the National Front are putting up a strong showing. It's happening in places like the Pas-de-Calais, which wouldn't traditionally have been the territory of the far right at all. But then Marine Le Pen is positioning herself as the protector of workers' rights, the champion of public services. It's all change. What's caused it? Many theories have been advanced. It's income equality, it's the effects of globalization, it's concerns about immigration, and certainly you heard a lot of that in Kent, where there isn't really very much immigration at all. It's a distrust of big business. It's any number of things. And social media has undoubtedly played a part. But perhaps all these things play into one overriding message. The people feel that the establishment has been failing to listen to them, and they're fed up with being ignored. Samuel Huntington was an American political scientist who directed Harvard's Center for International Affairs. He wrote several books, perhaps best known for one called The Clash of Cultures, which was published in 1993. That predicted that future wars would not be between countries, but between cultures. Quite far-sighted, really. More recently, his last book, published in 2004, was called Who Are We? And it was a book about America and its lost identity. It argued that US elites were dangerously out of touch with the American public on politics, foreign policy, and national identity. The reviews were fairly scathing at the time. His warning that a global elite of perhaps 20 million people would emerge with a grip on power, both economic and political, was seen as really far too far-fetched. He characterized the role of the tribe of Davos man. They have little need for national loyalty, view national boundaries as obstacles that thankfully are vanishing, and see national governments as residues from the past whose only function is to facilitate the elite's global operations. That description might have rankled with the regulars at the Belvedere Hotel in the midst of slopes, where for a few days every year, it's the hub of extraordinary gathering that is the World Economic Forum. But clearly, that description of Davos man would resonate with our Prime Minister. She who spoke so disparagingly about people in power who behave as if they have more in common with international elites, you can hear the sneer, international elites, than the people down the road, the people they employ, the people they pass in the street. And she said at the Conservative conference, in that memorable sentence, if you believe you're a citizen of the world, then you're a citizen of nowhere. You don't even understand the very word citizenship. Well, Mrs. May clearly understands what populism means. And that's certainly what we're getting now. The Brexit vote and the election of Donald Trump both represented a rising up against the elite. Michael Gove probably put his finger on it during the election the referendum campaign, when he announced that the public had had enough of experts. Strange, really, if experts aren't to be listened to. But that's the mood of the moment. For many people, recent times have been disappointing. In the UK, Michael Ashcroft's analysis of polling before for the referendum showed the single question most likely to determine how people would vote in the referendum was whether they thought that life in the UK had got better or worse in the last 30 years. It would appear that a majority of people think that life has got worse in the last 30 years. In the US, 81% of Trump supporters said that they thought life was better 50 years ago. They must have been the older ones. From an objective view, one could argue, would argue, that life in both countries has undoubtedly improved. Living standards have improved. Technology has made life easier. Washing machines, vacuum cleaners take the drudgery out of housework. Technology provides information and access to services on a scale that could never have been envisaged 30 or 50 years ago. Medicine's improved, lifespans increased. Nevertheless, millions of people are looking back and seeing a better life. Why? Well, money, of course. Money is always part of the answer. World Bank research shows that the lower half of households in developed countries have seen nearly no real income gains in 30 years. In the UK, average real wages are still significantly below where they were before the great crash of 2008. Research by the Pew Center in the US shows that average real hourly wages have barely grown since the 60s, hence the 50 years. Just about managing, the current catchphrase, is not much fun, and a lot of people are just about managing. When the discrepancies between the earnings of those at the top and those in the rest of the money chain become apparent, as they are doing today, people get very angry. The jams have reason to be aggrieved. Statistics show that in 2015, the chief executives of America's top 500 companies earned not 100 times, not 200 times, not even 300 times, 340 times the average worker's wage. The Federation of US Trade Unions, which produced the numbers, had to concede that actually the multiple had gone down from the previous year, where it was 373 times. The jams are unlikely to feel any sympathy for that drop in income. In the UK, the fall is the ratio is more modest. The average FTSE 100 chief exec gets a mere 183 times the earnings of the average worker. This ratio has widened exponentially in recent years, and I've yet to hear a believable justification for it. So money is undoubtedly part of the problem. Globalization is often cited. It's a spurious attempt sometimes to justify higher CEO payments, a global market for talent, we're told. The highest bidder secures the best. But there are other reasons why globalization is seen to have driven populism. Outsourcing of jobs in both manufacturing and services to countries where costs are cheaper. cheap imports of consumer goods aren't always seen as a reasonable trade-off. Anyone who campaigned in the 2016 referendum cannot be under any illusion either that immigration, the other side of globalisation perhaps, was a major factor influencing the vote, certainly in Kent. I heard little about parliamentary sovereignty when I was out there with my Remain stickers. And Lord Ashcroft's polling found that amongst those who voted Leave, the second most important reason was voting to have offered, the second most important reason for voting to leave was that it offered the best chance to regain control over immigration and the country's borders. The most important decision that was cited was the principle that decisions about the UK should be taken in the UK. Well, where in the UK is the question that comes to mind, and we'll get back to that. The wave of EU immigration has undoubtedly put strains on some communities where medical services, schools and so on have struggled to cope. By the first quarter of last year, approximately 2.2 million workers in the UK were born in other EU countries, and a total of 3.5 million of those born in other EU countries were living in the UK. It's a significant proportion, but by no means swamping us. The UK's statistics, official statistics on immigration, are woefully poor. We do really not have an accurate picture on what's happened in the last few years and what's going on now. And that's despite having had a Home Secretary who seems to think immigration is quite important. Migration Watch, the assiduous campaigner for clarity on the issue of migration, points out that last year, immigrants from outside the EU outnumbered those from inside, and asylum seekers coming via Europe contributed only a tiny fraction of the number. So the EU is not the only issue when it comes to talking about immigration. Some Brexiteers were opposed to the numbers of Eastern Europeans coming in, even though the evidence is that they make a positive contribution to the economy. Many others, however, were giving vent to an opposition to immigration per se. It's a nasty trend that's been let loose here. In the 1950s, that era to which some still hark back as a nirvana, racism was rife. Brexit has released another wave of it. In the wake of the vote, there were attacks on innocent Poles, but there's been an upsurge in racial abuse generally against people who are British and whose families have been British for generations. Saeed Abbasi, who used to chair the Conservative Party, has lived in this country. She's a third generation in her family to live in this country. She lives in Yorkshire, Pakistani origin. And she said she was used to racism when she was growing up, but her children have grown up in a society where they'd never heard, "Go home, Paki," until after the referendum. And just for being somebody who had changed her mind from being a leaver to become a remainer, and being perhaps coloured, she had death threats. She told me that she was waking up having nightmares because she had spent some time in Bosnia and seen at first hand the conflict between Serbs and Croats that had previously lived happily side by side. All of a sudden, from nowhere ostensibly, there came an upsurge of anger and neighbours were fighting each other. She was waking up in Yorkshire, terrified that suddenly, from nowhere, people would come over the hills wanting to drive her out. So immigration, clearly a huge issue that's setting forth all sorts of nasty tendencies. There's some evidence that migrant labour has helped to keep down wages, but there's also plenty of evidence that migrants are taking on the roles that the British are simply not prepared to undertake. roles are essential in this country. Earlier this week, the Economic Affairs Committee in the Lords, that I'm a member of, took evidence from people in the agricultural sector about what was likely to happen if the supply of EU migrant labour dries up. Basically, they said we wouldn't have very much to eat. We need EU immigrants who are prepared to come in and do the harvesting in this country. If we're not going to have them, and they're drying up already in supply, in part because of the falling value of our currency, but these people, members of the NFU, were suggesting that we will actually have to beg the government to give special work permits, seasonal work permits maybe, that will allow people from elsewhere in the world to be brought in to do the harvesting and the strawberry picking and to work in the abattoirs, which really most people from Britain seem very reluctant to do. I suspect that many of those who cited immigration as their motivation for voting for Brexit were simply using immigration as the hook on which to hang their general discontent with what's going on in the world and what's going on in their lives particularly. They feel alienated, and alienation, both in the state and in the UK, was one of the factors that did come up in the research over the referendum. People feel that the country in which they live is no longer the one in which they feel comfortable. Changing social mores are not what they want. Gay marriage is something very many of them were opposed to and remain opposed to. Social conservatives have been left feeling alienated. Older people were far more likely to vote to leave the EU than younger voters, perhaps broader-minded voters. Nearly three quarters of 18 to 24-year-olds voted to remain, as did 62% of 25 to 34-year-olds. Over 45, the balance changed marginally. But by the time people hit 65, there was a 60% chance that they would be voting to leave the EU. And so they did. The breakdown in communities has contributed to this. People feel lonely. They feel isolated. Their families have dispersed in some cases or broken up. And they don't have that sense of community which used to keep people together even when there were bigger problems such as financial ones. They feel alone. Hence, they hark back to an age when things might have been better. It's an emotional response, and I think that the response to the referendum was in many cases emotional rather than thoughtful. Some voters managed to take a more pragmatic approach. They genuinely believed that they wanted sovereignty. They looked at the EU and thought, as I'm sure many of us do, that it was a flawed organisation where reform is long overdue. And perhaps reform is something that the EU is incapable of carrying out. I disagree. I take the view that even Brussels can't be impervious to the wave of antipathy that swept across EU member states. I'm optimistic that there will be reform in Europe, that the EU will realise that it can't just keep interfering in more and more areas, spending more and more money, when the countries that pay the bills are actually having to cut back in other areas. But that, I confess, may be wishful thinking. There were some Brexit supporters who saw sovereignty and taking back control as the issue. So it's particularly ironic that it took a legal case to win for Parliament the right to vote on the bill to withdraw from the UK, when it takes a member of the public to take on the Prime Minister in the Supreme Court simply to assert the sovereignty of Parliament, one does begin to question just who's trying to grab back that control from Brussels. But let's not dwell on that. It was discontent with the status quo which, one way or another, prompted the Brexit vote. And that, of course, is what produces a change of government in an election. It's what prompted the election of Donald Trump in the United States. But what makes both Brexit and Trump more than just a run-of-the-mill change of heart by voters is the shrinking centre and the anger of such a high proportion of voters. The politics of rage that Martin Bath described and that some of us campaigning for Remain met. The Rand Corporation in the United States did some research and found that at the primaries, Republican voters were 80% more likely to vote for Trump rather than a more moderate candidate if they agreed with the statement that people like me don't have any say. They're cross about that. And the people in the UK and large tranches of Europe feel the same, that they're not being listened to, they're not getting a say. People feel the leaders are distant. This view relates to business as much as it does to politics. It fuels the resentment that Samuel Huntington wrote about. Davos man lives in a very, very nice bubble. And whether he's a politician or a businessman, he's not living in the same world as the average person. That's how they feel. In recent weeks, Edmund Burke has been much quoted in Parliament. In his speech to the electors of Bristol at the conclusion of the poll, he defended his view that members of Parliament were representatives of their constituents, but not delegates. He said, "It ought to be the happiness and glory of a representative to live in the strictest union, the closest correspondence, and the most unreserved communication with his constituents." Well, there's no doubt that the internet and email make sure that there is unreserved communication with MPs now. I don't think they always welcome it. He went on, "Their wishes," that's the constituents' wishes, "ought to have great weight with him." MPs, of course, were only he at that stage. "Their opinion, high respect. Their business, unremitted attention. It is his duty to sacrifice his repose, his pleasures, his satisfaction to theirs. And above all, ever and in all cases, to prefer their interests to his own." Does that ring true? Perhaps. I'm sure it describes the attitudes of today's members of Parliament, but Burke went on to say, "His," that is the MP's, "unbiased opinion, his mature judgment, his enlightened conscience, he ought not to sacrifice to you, to any man, or to any set of men living." Burke would not have had any truck with referenda. And this has been the prevailing view for decades. The people didn't want to do away with capital punishment. Parliament did, and hanging is no more in the UK. And yet, on Monday, Parliament will give a resounding majority to a policy which the majority of parliamentarians had until June the 23rd last year believed to be absolutely wrong. Could it be that parliamentarians really are so much worse than their predecessors at listening to what the electorate feel? That all of a sudden, they woke up on June the 24th with a realization that they were so out of touch that they had to change their minds and vote against their consciences for something in which they did not believe. I find it deeply, deeply worrying. It is true, of course, that to a certain extent, parliamentarians have now moved away from their constituents. The big issue is education. In the referendum, it was education which was one of the determinants of how people voted. A higher education pointed towards a Remain vote. And in this country, it's increasingly the case that those who have not had a higher education feel that they are looked down upon. Of course, these are generalisations, but it's harder to get a job without a degree now. Salaries are lower if you don't have a degree. And the elite, to which the populace are now so opposed, almost all have degrees. That is, of course, if you don't include sportsmen amongst the elite. And even that's changing. Many constituencies, which were working class constituencies, until quite recently, were represented by people who had grown up there, who understood the hopes and fears of their constituents. Mining constituencies were represented by miners, not by doctors or graduate solicitors. Tristram Hunt's constituency was, until quite recently, represented by a miner, it being Hanley, a mining village on the outskirts of Stoke. Tristram, of course, has now gone on, as you heard, to something different from mining, and I wish him well. I think he's going to have a great time at the V&A, but he is a loss to Parliament. Now that these constituencies are represented by graduates, many of whom have gone on to become SPADs and then found their way into Parliament, it's fair to say that they probably don't have the same bonds with some of their constituents as they used to do. I was horrified at one stage when I found that my older son had not one, but three friends who were special advisers to ministers. And I can assure you, they're really nice guys, but I wouldn't have asked their advice about anything. They had no experience of the wider world, but there they were, working hard towards determining policy. Anyhow, we are now witnessing a sea change, because the Prime Minister has insisted that Parliament must not just listen to the will of the people, but obey it unquestioningly. Burke would have fainted. But nevertheless, that's where we are. And so you have to ask, what has made the will of the people into such an angry force that cannot be denied? Well, some have cited fake news as part of the explanation. With its extreme tales, it's whipping up anger. There's certainly plenty of it about on the web. The Onion currently carries a story headlined, "Rodent clearly making its way through Steve Bannon's body throughout national security meeting." The White House chief strategist might be surprised to learn that. Or you can turn to World News Daily Report for a story that declares, "Poverty is genetic," says Trump's new billionaire education secretary. Well, that might inflame opinion in middle America. But before getting too enraged by such stories, people should take note of the disclaimer on the site. Admittedly, you have to look for it. It says, "All characters appearing in the articles on this website, even those based on real people, are entirely fictional, and any resemblance between them and any persons, living, dead, or undead, is purely a miracle." These sites are satire, and satire and worse has always been with us. But not so very well buried on the net are sites which do much more than entertain. There are stories that aim to really cause trouble, to do damage, to incite anger. And what makes it even worse is that organisations are paying to advertise on those sites. Somebody was prepared to put up quite a bit of money to fund the stories that insisted that Hillary Clinton was desperately ill in the weeks before the election, and that probably had an effect on the outcome. But fake news is certainly not new. In 1475, a complete untruth was told. The discovery of the body of a 2.5-year-old child in Trent, Italy, led to a report that he'd been murdered by Jews who wanted to drink his blood in order to mark Passover. This was shortly after the arrival of the printing press. Things were beginning to change. The Prince Bishop of Trent, coming across the story, ordered retribution. 15 Jews were slaughtered. More recently, the press hasn't been averse to using its imagination. The Zinoviev letter published by the Daily Mail in 1924 was thought to be a forgery. The Times coverage of Hitler's Germany in the 1930s was, to say the least, selective. And politicians have been known to play fast and loose with the actuality. William Hague's assertion in 2001 that there were 24 hours in which to save the pound, and the Labour Party's mantra that the electorate has just 24 hours to save the NHS, regularly trotted out at elections, are on a par with the proud boast on the side of the Brexit bus. Well, we all know that money isn't going back to the NHS, but people were prepared to stand in front of the bus, and the bus is still there in photographs with that boast, even though the Brexiteers who were responsible now disclaim it completely. There may well be some people who voted for Brexit who really believed that there were going to be hundreds of millions flowing back to the NHS. It's not just in general elections. Those of us who went through the Greenwich by-election with John Antcliffe in 87, when my husband was running a committee room for him, will recall that the SDP version of the truth varied, not just between constituencies, but within them. And I say that as somebody who does claim a few Lib Dem friends. But that's politics. The electorate should know that they have to greet campaigning rhetoric with a degree of scepticism. Admittedly, Donald Trump has taken the concept of fake news to a new level. His insistence that the turnout for his inauguration was a record, despite photographs which showed categorically this wasn't true, was bold, to say the least. For his spokesman to then go on and say that the White House position was merely a presentation of alternative facts was an innovative use of language. Innovative facts. Sorry, alternative facts. Trump now tells the world that his predecessor had his phone bugged. It's an allegation for which there's no evidence. It's roundly denied by the Obama camp, but that's not stopped the Donald. And the worrying thing is that I was talking only this morning to a friend who's just back from New York, and she said when she was there and the phone bugging story first broke, everybody was saying, oh, dreadful, how can he do these things? How can he make up such rubbish? What is going to happen to the states? But within a couple of days, they were just shrugging their shoulders and saying, oh, well, that's just him, isn't it? That's what Donald does. And it is. That's what he does. He does it all the time on Twitter. And here, I think, we get to what has really changed and what has enhanced the anger people feel about elites. Why they feel more inclined to fight for the moment thank goodness, only at the ballot box, but while they might feel inclined at some stage to fight elsewhere. The internet and social media in particular has changed the game. People gravitate to websites that enforce their own opinions and their prejudices. They feel empowered to voice their views in postings which betray a lack of tolerance on any view that differs from their own. As an editor, I used to get occasional letters in green ink. The green ink brigade, as we knew them, were known to all editors. Why they thought that green ink was the only colour in which to write nasty things, I don't know, but they did. But now, the internet leaves them free to write instant responses to anything they don't like, and they do. And as I found when I stuck my head up and said I was not entirely happy with the result of the referendum, and indeed might do my best to try and change it, the postbag I got was foul, absolutely foul. My poor PA, who had to open the ones that people had actually bothered to put stamps on, just really got depressed and horrified by it. And it wasn't just the abuse of slut, whore, harlot, anything you can think of, but generally with a sexist overtone. It was also the allegation that I was part of an establishment elite. I was a member of the unelected house. The rage that came through those emails and letters was palpable. These people were so angry. However, the good news, as far as I was concerned, was that I was then asked to write something for The Guardian. I love Guardian readers. Guardian readers write the nicest emails and the nicest letters you can possibly get. I'm happy now to write The Guardian for almost nothing. But what these letters and emails said was that you don't understand, you haven't been listening. You are out of touch. And business, I think, is to blame for part of this. Anger. Business has failed to listen to the public just as much as the politicians. I've done quite a lot of work, I have to say it was with Oxford, with the side business school there, and Populous, the researchers funded by DLA, the law firm, on trust in business and why it's gone so badly wrong of late. And it has, of course. And we came to the view that the problems were, A, that business elites just mixed with themselves. They were in little networks. They went to Davos. They didn't hear what was going on in the outside world. And certainly the surveys that we did of business leaders led us to that view, because actually they didn't think there was a great deal wrong. They thought any problems would blow away. And they just thought the best thing was to keep on doing what they were doing and keep their heads down. That's not how the public view it. But they keep to their little networks. They don't listen. So they don't realise that there are changing norms in society. Business has been very slow to wake up to the anger over the failure of big business to pay appropriate taxes. It's been very slow to wake up to the anger against those huge disparities in income that I talked about earlier. It's been very reluctant to learn. And so what we came up with as a way to try and rebuild trust in business was that business should respond by changing its networks, building bigger networks, listening to the outside world. And then it should be faster to respond to the changing norms in society. It's not been so bad on environmental matters, but on tax and remuneration, it has absolutely failed to respond and will get its comeuppance, because under the new populist governments that are coming, business will find that if it doesn't put its house in order, the government will start intervening to make it. And the other thing, the third N, because we all like acronyms, was norms, networks, narratives. Business has also failed dismally to tell the world about the good things that it does. And it does do some good things. And getting that message out about social responsibility is really important. We should hear more about it. And I think that those same three things could be equally applied to politicians. They need to listen more broadly. They need to start responding gently to changing norms, because if they respond gently and fast, then they won't have to do the huge catch-up that we're seeing now. And then they must be open about explaining what's going on. They must get the narrative right. So to conclude, because my time is coming to an end, I do believe that there's a fundamental change in the landscape, the political landscape. It's fueled by a failure of the elites to pay attention to evolving norms and by the new media's ability to exacerbate reactions. It is, as we're seeing, leading to a radical change in voter behaviour to the benefit of the populist movements around the world. And how the trend will finally evolve, I'm not entirely clear. In the UK, the Conservative Party is responding by moving in the direction of the populists. Optimists believe that it will not go too far in that direction, but just enough to quell the far right while the left remains in disarray. I hope that's right. I was somewhat disheartened, however, to hear the debate at the Conservative get-together last week, the Conservative conference, spring conference, where Michael Hard was calling for potential blocks on takeovers from overseas. He wanted many more tests applied that went far beyond the existing competition tests before companies from abroad could take over companies here. That sounds like the sort of protectionism that we're hearing from the states, America first, American jobs for American people. So there are risks by following the populist route. There are undoubtedly choppy times ahead. Francis Fukuyama, who was a former student of Samuel Huntington, the man who gave us Davos Man, summed up the position this way: the intellectual challenge is to see whether it's possible to back away from globalization without cratering both the national and the global economy, with the goal of trading a little aggregate national income for greater domestic equality. It's a fine aim. I think it will be difficult to achieve, but let's be optimistic that we can get there. Thank you.
Patience has agreed to take a few questions before we move on to drinks outside. Who would like to go first?
It's lovely to hear you speak. I'm an old friend of John's from the Cambridge days, and he always spoke very warmly and respectfully of you. So I'm sure he would he'll be looking down on us and be delighted that you're speaking. I stood in the Welsh Assembly elections in April last year. So although I didn't particularly campaign in the referendum, I had effectively a quasi-referendum campaign in those elections. And it strikes me that one of the points you made, that actually the top concern for people was bringing back control rather than immigration, which I think you said. I think in a way that was slightly missing from your analysis of the problem. And the impression I got from people was, yes, they were annoyed about certain things. I think the anger, the narrative, is slightly overdone. I think a lot of people had problems with the European Union as it exists today. And I think perhaps we should give him greater credit for a more sophisticated view of the failings of the European Union. And I think in a way that was slightly missing from your speech and analysis. And the other thing I would say is that in the American elections, I'm sure the situation with Hillary Clinton was part of the reason why Donald Trump won. And if they'd had a stronger and less flawed Democratic presidential candidate, he probably wouldn't have won.
Well, thank you, and I hope you're right on your first point, and that people actually were being calm and reasoned in their decision. They certainly weren't calm and reasoned when they were walking the streets of Kent and approaching me. And I think the trend that we're seeing really across the Western world indicates that there's something more at work than just not thinking that the EU is a good place to be. And when they talked about taking back control, I think for many people what that meant was taking back control of our borders to keep the immigrants out. So the two are inextricably linked in many minds, and keeping immigrants out is, I think, something that drove an awful lot of voters then. As far as Hillary is concerned, I mean, there is no doubt that the hatred of Mrs. Clinton and the Clintons generally was an undoubted factor in Trump being elected. But in part, surely, that wasn't just because the Clinton Foundation doesn't appear to have made many donations recently, but it was because Mrs. Clinton, having been the president's wife, represented the elite that they're so opposed to. And Trump positioned himself very much, extraordinary really, for somebody who's a billionaire businessman, as man of the people, who was going to solve their problems. So I think that there's an overlap before about our positions.
Ben Zeichner, a local member of parliament, so I guess to some extent part of the problem at unsurprisingly, much of what you said I recognise, but I think it's also important to remember that, I mean, had you been campaigning in Cambridge, it was a thoroughly pleasurable experience.
Next time.
But I wouldn't recommend Biggles Way based on my experience. And that, I think, rather makes the point. But also, both elections, exactly as has just been said, they were both actually very close. And part of the problem was both of the campaigns, the Remain's side and the Clinton campaigns, were very, very poor campaigns. And failed to inspire, I think that is part of the problem, perhaps we're not addressing, but the parties, the established parties, have lost the ability to actually inspire in any kind of way. And that, I think, is actually the much bigger problem. And of course, there is an alternative take on the rage out there, which is actually the mainstream parties have been basically done a very good job from the establishment's point of view for a century, and keeping the lid on gross unfairness in this country. One way of tackling that would be to tackle the gross unfairness. And of course, that perhaps explains why there are now 500,000 people who joined the Labour Party because of Jeremy Corbyn. So there are some different ways of seeing this.
Well, there has to be an explanation for why 500,000 people joined the Labour Party under Jeremy Corbyn. And I'm grateful to you for providing it. But you're right, and I absolutely agree with you, the unfairness. And that, of course, is what the executive salaries demonstrate, the real unfairness that's been allowed to fester in this country. And the other thing, huge topic, which really has made people very angry, is the housing situation. And I was surprised to find that back in 1963, Sir Keith Joseph, who was not known for his anti-free market views, postulated that actually it was the duty of government to determine where it wanted to have large-scale housing development, buy the sites at knockdown prices, and then grant them with planning permission to developers, whether public sector or private sector, in order to get housing really moving. And sadly, over 50 years, more than that, we've failed to grapple the housing problem down. And even though there's a lot of talk about it now, unless we do something radical along the lines that Joseph suggested, that will be a continuing unfairness to a lot of people in this country. So I absolutely take your point about that being an issue, and I think what it's done is make people very angry.
Yeah. Me? Yeah. Hello, I'm Philip Laporte. I'm a PhD student at this university. I was wondering you spoke a lot about the inequality in this country. You spoke about the income issue. You spoke about companies, big companies, the inequality between the working class people and the top 5% earners in this country. But these are all issues that do not really come up in the debates for the radical right populists. So they talk a lot about immigration, loss of control, loss of power, and so on. But they never really speak about these things, about inequality. And then I also, maybe apart from Maria Pan, most of the politicians who represent those radical right populists, like Donald Trump, or in other countries, Germany, Austria, it actually turns out that these politicians are rather liberal in terms of economical views. So where does this discrepancy come from, and what can we do about it?
I think the second question is by far the hardest. If you look at Marine Le Pen and the sort of thing she's talking about, it typifies the varied pick and mix approach to politics that we are seeing from quite a few people. And Trump is another one who's got a mixed bag of views. You know, he's building a wall, he's taking down Obamacare, and yet he's positioning himself as the friend of the American worker. So I think there's a degree of confusion in the policies that are being presented all over the place, really. But your starting point, the public don't talk about these issues, really. Well, they certainly don't in the UK, or they haven't done particularly, because what they were given to vote on was the referendum. And so my contention is that actually they use the referendum as a means of venting the anger that they feel over all these things. And I know it's not representative, but if you went through some of the emails and the letters that I had, their discontent and their anger and their feeling that there is this inequality come shining through. And in particular, it is this disconnect with the elite that they see. And Samuel Hodkinson thought that there could be maybe 20 million people in the world who would get into that group, but that left an awful lot of other people outside it. And I don't know if it's 20 million now, but there are undoubtedly huge discrepancies between those who are going to Davos, and take it from me, you don't need to go every year. Two or three times is quite enough. those who go to Davos and those who really are struggling in this country, in the States. So they may not be shouting about it at the moment, perhaps because they've been given other things to shout about. But I do believe that actually what's motivating them is in part that inequality that they're very conscious of, because they're living it.
Yeah.
My name is Vanessa Monatol. I'm a first year PhD student in the politics department. I have a question. I'm really curious to your thoughts about responses to rage and populism, because we have spent a lot of time on explaining and understanding, but what should be your responses as people who are trained in a more like rational manner of going about problems? Like, how do we relate to this kind of responses in a way that really speaks and connects and bridges the gap more than sort of say, well, they and we? I'd really like to hear some thoughts on that.
I was hoping you could tell me. And perhaps we should ask our MP how on earth people are going to relate to the problems. You know, how are people who are supposed to be responding and making life better, which is for what people go into Parliament for, how are they supposed to respond? And I think that part of the difficulty is that many people in Parliament all over feel that actually their influence is limited. And particularly in the last few days, I found it quite depressing to see people who I know believe one thing voting differently. Now, that's for all sorts of reasons, but people need to go into politics because they want to actually do what you're suggesting and make the case for the poor and the underprivileged and help them. they need to relate to them.
Now we have loads of questions. Should we take the back?
Hi, my name is Nora Kalinsky. I'm a finalist undergraduate in the politics department. I wanted to come back to the title of the lecture, so Politics in the Post-Truth Age. And I wanted to ask you first, do you agree that we are currently entering a post-truth age as opposed to before? And further, well, facts have always been bent by interpretations, and they always will be, in the sense that even when someone writes a report about what has happened and brings it to a minister, that person's experience and view of the world will automatically inform the way they write up these events, as opposed to someone else. So what place do you think truth has in politics?
I think that, as I'm sure our MP would say, truth is all about politics and politics is all about truth. But as I said, it's often been the case that politicians have struggled to actually tell things exactly as they are. I think what was actually quite interesting yesterday in Philip Hammond's budget was that it differed distinctly from other budgets I have known. When I was a journalist, we used to dread budget day, and then it was made even worse because we got two budget days a year, and one knew that in the speech, things might be all upbeat and hunky-dory, and then the task would be to wade through all the tomes from HMRC and from the Treasury and the Red Book and find out what the real story was. I think what we got from Philip Hammond yesterday was that absolutely unprecedented thing, a budget that was exactly as he said it. Nobody seems able to have found the hidden story. So that's truth. That's a move in the right direction, undoubtedly. But fake news is going to be more and more of a problem, I think. It will influence what people do. You know, there was a shooting in the States. Somebody went into a pizza restaurant, fired off a gun several times in response to something that he'd read on a fake news site. And one hopes that people will be able to distinguish between what is fake and what is real. It's increasingly difficult to do so in an age of social media when all sorts of rubbish gets posted. Trump's approach is a novel one, as I say, and that's perhaps it means that actually nobody will take any notice of what Trump says, which could be a good thing. But I get quite depressed too about the more mainstream media, which, because of the stresses it's under, given the cuts in resources and the ever-increasing demands, actually the mainstream media is becoming, in part of the post-truth age. There used to be a very close distinction between what was news, the facts, the truth, and what was comment. And now, even in the Times, you will find it very hard to find a news story that doesn't have an element of comment in it. And that's a slippery slope. So what I hope is that there will actually be not just another onion sprouting up with loads of rubbish, but actually there will be a move towards new media sites which are attempting to do what the best old media did, and that people will be prepared to subscribe to them.
Should we take two or three more?
Yes.
And then drinks.
Then drinks.
Yeah.
Hi, George Lee. I'm a payer policy. It's actually somebody who used to go to Davos a lot, and also I was doing this PPC for the Conservative Party in 2010. How much do you think the problem we're facing today is very much your lead shooting themselves in the foot? Because, you know, when you actually ask members of the public what their concerns are during elections, it's economy, it's health, it's education, and some kind of law and order, never really the EU. So how much is it that we've actually created this problem for ourselves, and how do we put the genie back in the bottle?
In my experience, putting genies back in bottles was very difficult. And I think you're right. On the doorstep, when one's campaigning in elections, the EU was never something that cropped up. And so, for his own reasons, and more to do with his own party, than the country, I think. David Cameron took the decision to have a referendum because the division in the Conservative Party had been one that had rankled on for 40 years, and he thought, I believe, that it was a clever gamble that the Conservatives could promise in their manifesto that there would be a referendum, and then they wouldn't have an outright victory in the election. They'd be another coalition with the Lib Dems who would do the decent thing and say no to any referendum, and then we'd all live happily ever after. But the best laid plans, I'm afraid. And it wasn't just about, well, this is really why I come to my contention, but it was not about the EU. It was a vote about discontent.
Graham Wiley, student at the Judge Business School. You've talked about how this discontent has come through in terms of the age of education. But something I find very interesting in the UK is the geographic implications, because it doesn't reflect the traditional political working patterns at all. And I wonder what your thoughts are to how that is going to play out going forward.
It's not just this country that is divided geographically as well as politically, but undoubtedly there is a north-south divide. There are exceptions to that, of course. There are parts of the south, Cornwall, for instance, which are deeply depressed. And actually, Cornwall is, and it remains the next short term, one of the major recipients of EU money. So it's not just north-south. We have many deprived areas in this country. If you go to the states, each state has its own characteristics. I was there in November, in Detroit, left in no doubt that it would be a Trump victory. And then in December, I was lucky enough to go to New York, which was ruinously expensive, thanks to Brexit. But you couldn't be in New York and not think, oh, it's fine, this is a cultured city, it's open, it's going to go with Hillary. And there is a country that really is divided. And we have to begin to deal with that problem. Education is obviously part of it. Infrastructure is part of it. But it takes a long time to address something that's been allowed to fester for so long. We can encourage industry to move, and we should encourage government to move. There's been a token gesture in the past, and moving some public sector jobs out of London. But the tendency has been to move just the clerical jobs and not the higher income jobs, which would begin to transform areas. And so we need to get serious about that. There was one attempt, but then the civil servants, the senior civil servants who'd had to move, ran up such extraordinary transport bills and accommodation bills that the government caved in and they came back. But we just need to be absolutely determined. And if you look at what Salford has done, the BBC's determination to actually defy most of its journalists and move quite a lot of jobs to Salford, that's beginning to change that area. So I think government could be a bit more interventionist that way, but it's a long task.
I'm Robert. I'm a fourth year up in St Andrews, and I came down for this talk, and thank you, it was definitely worth coming down for. But just to go back to this lady in the back said about the title, about it being post-truth, right? It's the idea that we live in a democracy, and your opinion is just as good as my opinion, and there's no overarching truth in society. There's always been some kind of authority which truth has been laid in, whether it's religion or science, and what I really think that needs to be brought up is the idea that science has been completely delegitimized in society. And as someone who worked for so long in the newspaper industry, you'll see that the Daily Mail say there's a new cure for cancer one day, this gives you cancer the other day, etc., etc. And there's this massive cacophony of voices. And I'd just like to hear your thoughts on how we can get science back into its rightful place.
Well, let me give you my thoughts on the Daily Mail first. because it was the Daily Mail, of course, that coined the phrase Frankenstein foods. And that is just typical of what I think is one of the most dangerous organisations led by one of the most dangerous men in Britain. And if it sounds as if I got an axe to grind, I have. I was on a boat last summer and I talked about Brexit. And the audience was, like the country, divided down the middle. And we had, undoubtedly, a spirited discussion at the end. Now, one or two people might even have walked out. I was, however, stunned to read in the Daily Mail on my return that there had been a lynch mob after me. Of course, the Daily Mail hadn't tried to check with me, or indeed with Cunard, whether this was true, because it was an entertaining story and somebody had rung them up and told them. And needless to say, it was lifted by the Sun, by which stage it had become a mutiny. So we are undoubtedly in a post-truth age as far as some mainstream media are concerned. And I think that's dangerous. I think the influence of the Daily Mail is pernicious, and science stories in newspapers are undoubtedly written in sensationalist ways. So whether it be the latest cancer cure or Frankenstein foods, it's rarely done in a sensible way unless you get to The Economist or, well, The Economist, really. I would like to see it change. The only way it's going to change is if scientists are somehow more available to the public. And one of the really interesting things that's happening, and thank you for coming along tonight, but there's a growing appetite for lectures. And there is an appetite for science. And you will find at the Wellcome Institute, for instance, that there are large audiences for lectures on science. I'm involved with the British Museum. We have a thriving lecture program, and people come along to hear all about not just history, but the scientific experimentation that's going on some of the mummies that we've got, for instance. So I wouldn't be totally downhearted, but I think science has to, in that awful word, make itself more accessible, perhaps, not in a Daily Mail way, but in a way that people will pay attention to and actually be cheered by. I was absolutely riveted to listen to Chris Hadfield last year. And Chris Hadfield is the Canadian who ran the International Space Station for 18 months or so. And he came along, and unlike me, he's rather good with PowerPoint. We had a wonderful, wonderful slideshow of what he saw from up there at the space station. And then, in a way I certainly couldn't do, he then got hold of his guitar and played David Bowie's Spaceman and sang it very well. So multi-talented. But what was really interesting about him was his absolute conviction that in 20 years, we would be colonising space. But there are some fascinating stories to be told, and I think there is an appetite to hear them, but not in a Daily Mail type way.
So I think we should have one more question. Do anyone of our sixth form audience, I think the last word should go to someone young. Yeah.
The future.
Hi, my name is Nisha, I'm from Holland Park School. I thought it was really interesting to talk about the rise of racism after Brexit. And I was wondering whether you thought that was as a result of people just having an outlet finally to, you know, let loose on what they actually thought, or whether that was just covering up the greatest discontent that you spoke about.
The greatest?
Discontent that you spoke about.
I think it was a lot of letting off steam, quite honestly. And the cheering thing was that young people in huge numbers were in favour of remaining. And actually, in families where there were young children under 11, there was a much much greater tendency to vote Remain as well, because it was seen as being a brighter future. And one of the things that we failed to get over during the campaign at all was the benefits to young people of something like the Erasmus programme. Now, I don't know whether you were thinking of heading off to Europe to go to university, but the opportunity to do that is fantastic. And nobody talked about Erasmus during the campaign at all. So I think, you know, I feel very guilty about what we're doing for your generation.
On that note. I said before, I felt that it was a very topical subject. We've had a fascinating, wholly topical talk about some of the biggest questions in contemporary politics. Please join me in thanking Baroness.
Thank you.